Blackstone Publishing presents Birds of America, Stories by Lorrie Moore. This book is read by Natasha Soudek. This book is for my sister and for my parents and for Benjamin. It is not news that we live in a world where beauty is unexplainable and suddenly ruined and has its own routines. We are often far from home in a dark town, and our griefs are difficult to translate into a language understood by others. Charlie Smith, The Meaning of Birds. Is it Okali or Kankari? Is it really Jug-Jug? Is it Cuckoo, for that matter? Much less whether a bird's call means anything in particular, or at all. Amy Clampett, Syrinx. Willing. How can I live my life without committing an act with a giant scissors? Joyce Carol Oates, An Interior Monologue. In her last picture, the camera had lingered at the hip, the naked hip, and even though it wasn't her hip, she acquired a reputation for being willing.
You have the body, studio heads told her over lunch at Chasen's.
She looked away. Habeas corpus, she said, not smiling.
Pardon me?
A hip that knew Latin. Christ. Nothing, she said. They smiled at her and dropped names. Scorsese, Brando. Work was all playtime to them. Playtime with gel in their hair. At times, she felt bad that it wasn't her hip. It should have been her hip. A mediocre picture, a picture queasy with pornography. These, she knew, eroticized the unavailable, the doctored and false, the stand-in. Unwittingly, she had participated, let a hip come between, a false, unavailable, anonymous hip. She herself was true as a goddamn dairy product, available as lunch whenever. But she was pushing 40. She began to linger in juice bars, sit for entire afternoons in places called I Love Juicy or Orange You Sweet. She drank juice and, outside, smoked a cigarette now and then. She'd been taken seriously, once. She knew that. Projects were discussed. Nina, Portia, Mother Courage with makeup. Now her hands trembled too much, even drinking juice, especially drinking juice, advantage wobbling between her fingers like a compass dial. She was sent scripts in which she was supposed to say lines she would never say, not wear clothes she would never not wear. She began to get obscene phone calls and postcards signed, "Oh yeah, baby." Her boyfriend, a director with a growing reputation for expensive flops, a man who twice a week glowered at her fancy sunburst guppy and told it to get a job, became a Catholic and went back to his wife. "Just when we were working out the bumps and chops and rocks," she said. Then she wept.
"I know," he said. "I know."
And so she left Hollywood, phoned her agent and apologized. Went home to Chicago, rented a room by the week at the Days Inn, drank sherry, and grew a little plump. She let her life get dull. Dull with hostess cakes. There were moments bristling with deadness when she looked out at her life and went, "What?" Or worse, feeling interrupted and tired, "What?" It had taken on the shape of a terrible mistake. She hadn't been given the proper tools to make a real life with, she decided. That was it. She'd been given a can of gravy and a hairbrush and told, "There you go." She'd stood there for years, blinking and befuddled, brushing the can with the brush. Still, she was a minor movie star, once nominated for a major award. Mail came to her indirectly. A notice, a bill, a Thanksgiving card. But there was never a party, a dinner, an opening, an iced tea. One of the problems with people in Chicago, she remembered, was that they were never lonely at the same time. Their sadness has occurred in isolation, lurched and spazzed, sent them spinning fizzily back into empty, padded corners, disconnected and alone. She watched cable and ordered in a lot from a pizza place, a life of obscurity and radical calm. She rented a piano and practiced scales. She invested in the stock market. She wrote down her dreams in the morning to locate clues as to what to trade. Disney, her dream said once. St. Jude's Medical. She made a little extra money. She got obsessed. The words, cash cow, nestled in the side of her mouth like a cud. She tried to be original, not a good thing with stocks, and she began to lose. When a stock went down, she bought more of it, to catch it on the way back up. She got confused. She took to staring out the window at Lake Michigan, the rippled slate of it like a blackboard gone bad.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.